So anybody is asking for the anybody will ask the admit them.
Sorry.
Anybody I'll ask. Meaning some people wants to join in between. So just to ask them to. I mean there is a you admit them actually. So there is a icon will come. It will just admit.
Okay, I'm just admitting it. Okay.
Okay. Okay. So. Good evening all. So today I am going to tell about the imaging part of cranial stereotaxy. It is from the structural to functional. As you hope you know me, and I am just will complete within half an hour. So what a radiation oncologist wants, it is a clear identification of a target and where and good resolution. So if you see. You take the the margin is the meaning boundary is the doubt only. If you take extra margin, there will be a side effect is more. If you take the less margin, the recurrence will be more. So what to do? What are the situations in we can go for the radiation in cranial stereotaxy? Mostly metastasis, vestibular schwannoma, meningioma, AVM, pituitary, re-radiation, trigeminal neuralgia, glomus jugulare. Cavernomas, hamartomas, cyst, and spine. So, what are ammunitions we have? We have a CT scan, plain, contrast, cysteinography, CT angio, MRI plain, MRI contrast, double contrast, triple contrast, delayed contrast, cystern MRI cysteinography, MR angio, MRS, and other functional sequences, and nuclear imaging, and digital subtraction angiogram. So, what are the basics before going to things? We have to go for the basics. What is slicing? What is windowing? What is CT number? What is how to measure the density? What is the contrast? And what is the FOV and bore? So slicing is nothing. You just have to all body image. You have to make a slice. There are three types of slices. One is the if you go side by side, it is called side view or sagittal view. If you go frontal view, it is called coronal view, AP view, or bottom up view is called axial view, and that is these three things I am showing here. This is the coronal plane, this is the horizontal plane, this is the sagittal plane. So this is the imaging planes. If you see, this is the axial, this is side to side view, this is the sagittal, this is the anteroposterior view, this is the coronal. Then let's see the window width and the window level. Brightness refers to the overall lightness or darkness of the image. Any image has a two properties, one is the brightness, one is the contrast. Brightness is the known as a level, contrast is known as a width. What happens to brightness? If you see the brightness of the left image, if you change the brightness, whole image will change. If you change the contrast, the image inside in the image change. So if you see this left side image, whole body changes, whole figure changes, but here in the contrast, the face is more brighter than other part of the body. So how to do that? Just drag your mouse vertically, the window level or window brightness will change. You go for the, you drag your mouse in horizontal direction, the width or contrast will change. If you go diagonal, your move your mouse in diagonally, the both will change. You can adjust your window level according to the need. So what are the window levels in the brain windowing? There are three windows are very important. One is the brain window, one is the bone window, one is the subdural window. Brain window width is 80, window level is 40. Bone window width is 2500 and window level is 480. Subdural window, which is not important for us, mostly it is useful for the injuries. There are bore, what is bore and what is the FOV. Bore is the total opening of the aperture of the CT or MR. It is called bore. FOV is different. FOV means the field of view. It is the maximum diameter of the area of the scanned object that is represented in the reconstructed image. So there is a FOV. You can see the part of the image. This is a small FOV to give a good resolution. It is a full FOV. That is the total image. But this is a tricky.
Sorry, Dr. Kanu, I am interrupting you. Dr. Varsha and Dr. Arya has written that, sir, your voice is not audible. So I think they have some problem in their internet, because I am very much, you are very audible to me.
Okay. I am trying to just now I am audible.
Dr. Varsha, you can unmute yourself. Dr. Varsha and Dr. Arya, is it audible? Yeah, they have written it's audible now.
Okay. So FOV and full FOV and small FOV, that is very important. If you take small FOV like spine, it will be resolution will be very good. But if you take full FOV, resolution may be less. But in our practice, we need CTMR fusion. In that fusion, we have to take the full FOV. When you're asking for a radiologist to give the images, we should ask for the full FOV so that you can mesh will be proper. But if you take a small FOV, mesh will not be proper. So it is a one guideline we have to ask to the radiologist. So describing the tissues and organs in CT scan, it is like brain, isodense and density. CT scan is called density, MRI is called intensity. So CT scan is called isodense if it is like brain. Less than brain is called hypodense. More than brain is called hyperdense. MRI, like brain is isointense. Less than brain is hypointense. More than brain is the hyperintense. So in X-ray or CT or MR, most of the radiolucent structures are not hypointense, hypointense or hypodense. That is all the A, spinal fluid, ischemic infarct, edema, and white fundus. These are the radiolucent. Radiodense is the mostly bone, metal, calcium, blood, gray matter, relics, hyperdense. So what is Hounsfield unit? Hounsfield unit is otherwise called a CT number. That is a different type for the different tissue related to the composition of tissue. So if you see the Hounsfield unit, it is start from the minus 1000 to plus 1000. Minus 1000 is the A, plus 1000 is the bone, and water is zero. So all other things are inside the air and bone. So it is given by who invented CT, Graffy Hounsfield. These are the various Hounsfield units by various structures, mostly CSF 8, white matter 30, gray matter 45, like that. So you can remember or you can take a opinion from Esperior. Google, it is available in free level in Google. So how to measure the Hounsfield unit? If you see, you take a, in any, you have a picture or archiving communication system. If you have, you take the CT and just drag the Hounsfield unit here. You will see the contrast area is 255. Long is minus 775. Here bone is the 270. Like that, soft tissue is 54. So you can measure in the various structures in the brain also. So this is the contrast. What is the contrast? If you see, mostly we in the government institution, there will auto injector will not be there, and people they give manual contrast injections. So manual contrast injections we should avoid, because when you ask for the arterial phase, we should not give manual contrast. We should be auto injector. We should if you put auto injector, you can have the good arterial phase you can see. So MRI brain sequences in stereotaxy. These are the basics what I have told everybody should know. Now MRI brain sequences in stereotaxy. There are three sequences are structural sequence, functional sequence, and tractography. Structural sequence mostly see the anatomic property. Tractography is the nerve tract, and functional is the measuring the brain activity. These are the various brain sequences are available. So what is a sequence? Sequence is the sequence of events in MRI machine. By varying the sequence of radio frequency pulses applied, different types of images are created. So the tricky here is that we have various companies called Philips, GE, Toshiba, Siemens, and Hitachi. So these machines are different company, but the sequence are same, sequences are different to different companies. There is no universal rule. But T1, T2, player sequence are more common name for all, but other sequences are different. So what is TR and TE? TR is the repetition time, the time between two excitations. T is the echo time, the time interval in which signals are measured after the RF excitation. So when you go for the MR basics, it will be clear. But no, I am not going to this here. So if you see, adjust the TR, TE, and TI, you can adjust. You can generate various sequences. So if there is a soft TE, soft TR, you can go for the T1 sequence. and long T, long TR, you can go for the T2 sequence. So this is no need to know all sequences, no need to know. And this is radiologists will provide. So we just understand I am showing this. So what is the T1 sequence? T1 sequence is the normal sequence. You can see fat is bright here. There are two things, white matter, gray matter. So if you see the CSF here, CSF looks black. White matter is white. White matter is inside, gray matter is outside. Remember, gray matter is outside, white matter is inside. So white matter looks white, gray matter looks black. So the gray. So this is the T1 sequence. If you T1 contrast, if you can see, identify the T1 contrast, you can see here, T1 contrast.
So please mute yourself. There is so much of noise coming from others' voice. So please mute yourself. Everyone, it's request to please mute yourself.
Dr. Rasmi, you can mute you all.
From where, Dr. Kanu? Mm-hmm.
Okay, with the participants, you can go. Mute all will come.
Okay. I am muted.
Okay, I am audible?
Yes.
Okay, so T1 contrast, you can see here, you can see the contrast agent, you can see the vessels in gold. Then T2 sequence, it is the flip side of the T1. How you identify the T1? See the CSF. CSF is very white and fat is black. Here, white matter is dark and gray matter is whiter. So this is the flip side of the T1. And you can see also how to identify the T1. It is, you can see the eyeball, that is vitreous and of course humor, CSF, it is white. Then it is the, you can see the blood vessels in the T1 are looks darker. That is a very important thing you have to remember. Flare sequence, you can see the flare sequence, you can identify the flare sequence by the ventricular ooze. You can see here ventricular ooze here. And the edges of the ventricle. Hello. This is the ventricular ooze. You can see the ventricular ooze here, so that you can understand this is a flare sequence. So let's see T2 and flare sequence. T2 is the here the CSF as well as the pathological fluid is white, but in flare sequence the T2 CSF is now black and pathological fluid is white. So now identify yourself. This is CSF is black, it is a T1 weighted. CSF is white, it is a T2 weighted. If there is a ooze, ventricular ooze, you can see the edges of the ventricle, it is a flare sequence. So it is very easy to identify now. T1 is the black CSF, T2 is the white CSF, T2 flare is the ventricular ooze here. Now MR diffusion, it is a ghost sequence, otherwise called, it is a diffusion weighted image, it is a fluid restriction and which is looks whiter here. So any pathological tumor, it looks whiter. So how to measure the how much restriction of fluid is there? If there is a large tumor, if there is a high populated tumor like glioblastoma, anaplastic astrocytoma, there will become, there is a restricted diffusion of the water. So it is called diffusion sequence. Like looks like a ghost, you can, it is a hyper intense in the structure. So how to measure how much restriction is there? That is called diffusion weighted imaging. To measure, it is called ADC, apparent diffusion coefficient. Apparent diffusion coefficient. So in DWI, it is the looks brighter, but in ADC, it looks black. So this is called ADC image, this is called diffusion weighted image. So if you see the ADC values, you can see the WHO grade 1 here, it is high, but WHO grade 4, metaloblastoma, PNETs, and glioblastoma is very low. So you can, according to the pathology, according to the grading, you can see the ADC value decreases, the diffusion restriction is there. Same thing, if you see the other brain tumors, craniopharyngioma is the more, and see the malignant lymphoma, it is very less. So low ADC value means there is a higher restriction of fluid diffusion and it is a more malignant. But other in other way, the edema fluids, vasopericumeral edema, edema fluid ADC is very high. Acute stroke it is less. So when you see the restriction, you have to see this. When you ask for the planning MRI, stereotaxy, you have to ask for a planning MRI. You should ask for MRI brain, contrast agent, double contrast if there is MEDS, T1, T2 sequence, higher sequence, 3D FSVGR, no gap, no tilt, neutral neck, 1mm slice, 512 matrix. These things you have to write in your paper and give to the radiologist. So, but you should write, FOB should include body control. If you don't write, they will not give, and if there will be difficulty in very fusion, and fusion may not be okay. There is one sequence called FSVGR sequence. You can see here, you can brightly, the tumor you can see here, this is FSVGR sequence. You can see the FSVGR sequence is the best sequence to identify the normal structures as well as the tumor. So in disease specific MRI sequence, in normal anatomy, you need a 3D FSVGR sequence, pituitary adenoma star sequence, trigeminal neuralgia fiesta sequence, cranial nerve CISC sequence, CP angle tumor GRE sequence, glioma, you can see diffusion and perfusion, AVM angio sequence, grading of tumor MRS, metastasis, you can ask for the double, triple, delayed contrast, diffusion, perfusion. So this is the one table, it will guide you to what sequences you should ask in your, to the patient, radiologist. Let's start one by one. One is called FSVGR sequence, also called 3D FSVGR sequence. More differentiation of normal structures you can see. Contrast as well as non-contrast improves the anatomical display. You can see this is called FSVGR sequence. Remember, when you are writing an MRI, please give the FSVGR sequence. So I am showing here, you cannot see the optic chiasma in clearly in T1, T2. You can see here in FSVGR sequence, you can see the pituitary stalk as well as the optic chiasma here. So, but the tricky is here, the FSVGR sequence is, it is in G, but in Philips it is called T1C FFB sequence, Siemens it is called Empyrean sequence. So you have to remember this when you are sending a radiologist according to the various companies, the sequence name changes here. Then otherwise, another sequence called Fiesta sequence, that is called fast imaging employing steady state acquisition. It is mostly used for cranial nerves and seeing the cisterns. You can see the cisterna here. Mostly clear visualization of the ventricles. These are the Fiesta sequence. So you can see the cranial nerve here. When you are asked for the Fiesta sequence, Vista sequence, CISS sequence, these are the sequences you can ask when you see the cranial nerve. Another sequence is called star sequence, fat saturated, fat cell sequence. That is a sequence to decrease the background fat to null separation. How to do that? You can see in a in pituitary tumors, the after spinodal surgery, they will take with a material that is called taking material, either form of gel foam, head. So it looks so you cannot differentiate from the pituitary adenoma and the taking material. In that situations, you should ask for the head start sequence or star sequence. You can see the taking material. So you can do that here. You can start sequence. Another sequence is called MRS sequence, magnetic resonance spectroscopy, chemical measurement. You can see the chemical environment of the scan. You can measure the chemical environment. You can differentiate the tumor. So this is the chemical environment. Mostly choline is low, creatinine is more than that, and NA is the neuronal activity. It is more, but in tumor it is a choline increases, creatinine decreases, NNA decreases. So NNA is a neuronal activity, is a good metabolite. Choline is a bad metabolite. Lipid lactate, which gives a ugly metabolite, is a necrotic tumors. So when you have the contrast, it gives a vascularity. Diffusion gives the micro architecture and diffusion. Perfusion gives new angiogenesis. Spectroscopy gives a chemical environment. So you can see here, low-grade gliomas, choline-creatinine ratio is 1.46. High-grade gliomas, choline-creatinine ratio is 3.9. But again, low-grade gliomas, NNA is more high. High-grade gliomas, NNA is very low. So, and this is the choline-creatinine ratio, it is 1.2. So, when you ask for MRS, they will give a normal background, they will give a tumor advance. You just compare. So you can see the, you can differentiate low grade gliomas and high grade gliomas. Another thing is that the meningiomas. So meningiomas and meningioma mimic tumors, like any other meningioma tumors you are not able to differentiate, you can ask for the alanin MRS, increase in alanin. So alanin MRS is also differentiating the meningioma from the meningioma mimicking tumors. MR angio, another thing is called it vascular. You can differentiate stenosis, occlusion, aneurysms and other abnormalities. MR perfusion. MR perfusion, you can see the vascularity around the tumor. That is called MR perfusion. You can, that is called a B, blood volume, blood flow. You can see if the blue background is the normal and the reddish and yellowish background is the hyperperfused. These are the MR perfusion. So you can measure the blood volumes at that point. So there are types of MR perfusion. There is a dynamic susceptibility contrast, dynamic contrast enhance, atrial skin leveling. But the thing is that these three are out of scope, so no need to discuss much. Another called gradient ecosequence. When there is a CT angle tumor, cerebellopontine angle tumor, most of the two tumors are very common. One is the meningioma, another is the upper stick neuroma. So how to differentiate? GRE sequence, gradient ecosequence, GRE sequence or gradient recalled ecosequence, it will show small changes in the background. In this upper stick neuromas, you can see the cyst formations, hemorrhages, but you will not find in the meningiomas. So this is the upper stick neuroma, you can see here. And this is the cyst formation, hemorrhages and cyst formations in the gradient ecosequence, but in meningioma, you will not find yet here. So this is the CT angle tumor in there is a doubt, meningioma versus upper stick neuroma, you can call for the gradient ecosequence. So then now one by one things we will discuss here. There are planning MRI, I told these things before, no gap, no tail, neutral neck, full FOB, you can ask for this thing. Apart from that metastasis, you can ask for the double contrast, triple contrast and a delayed contrast. So see, this is a single dose of contrast, this is a double dose of contrast. You can see the resolution as well as the boundary. You can clearly visualize. Like that, if you give single dose and double dose, the margin, the boundaries looks more brighter. And number also increases. There is a single dose. This single dose and this is a triple dose. Number also increases. And there is a another phenomenon is more Tesla. This is 1.5 Tesla. This is 7 Tesla. You can compare the images with 1.5 Tesla and 7 Tesla. If you are in your city, it is highest Tesla is available. Take the advantage of that so that you will not miss any tumor in your target delineation. Another is a delayed contrast. If you see, there is no lesion here after contrast, but 10 minutes, there is one lesion and 15 minutes and more resolution. So delayed contrast also useful in the metastasis planning. So another contrast is called garbutoral. What we use gadolinium, and if you use garbutoral also, there is a contrast enhancement will be more and a visualization will be more. So this is for what I told about the imaging for the neural metastasis. Planning MRI, trigeminal neuralgia. If you see the planning MRI, the basic sequence, the basic is there. But if you planning trigeminal neuralgia, there is specific sequences called Fiesta or CISS sequence for the cranial nerve and brainstem, T2 for cochlea, MRI angio for to see the vessel, CTMR for CT cystinography, and same slice thickness you should ask. Let's see. What is the CT cystinography? CT cystinography is nothing. We just take the spinal tap and give the contrast material to the spinal canal, and you can see the foot and elevation. You can see the cranial nerves, ventricles, cysts, and brainstem easy way. So this is the cystinogram. This is CT cystinogram. You can see the cysts here regularly, clearly, and ventricles. So you can see here. This is a Fiesta sequence. What I told previously, you can see the cisternal part of the trigeminal nerve. You can see the trigeminal cisternal part of the trigeminal nerve. So this is the you can see here, this is the cisternogram, and you can see here this rounded structure here. This is the T2. You have to find out the cochlea. You have to contour this one. Now, MR systemography, like CT systemography, you can do the MR systemography. It is available. We can take the advantage there also. So, in trigeminal, what happens? This is the trigeminal nerve. This is the vessel, superior cerebellar vessel. This is the conflict point. You have to give 80 to 90 gray here. So, you have to find out very cautiously because adjacent to the brain system. So, in this key sequence, you have to take the this vessel identification, take the MR angio. If this identification, you can take for the system, fiesta sequence and fuse it all together to get the target. Then planning for the arteriovenous malformation, same sequence for basic MRI. Apart from that, you ask for the 3D DSA and MR angio. So what is that? What is the DSA? Digital subtraction angiography. What is that? The name itself, it is an angiogram, but it is a background subtraction. So what they will take, this is a fluoroscopic machine here, and this is the they will take the image. After taking the image, they will contrast image they will take here. They will deduct the bone and soft tissue from the angiogram breakdown. So they will deduct, you will get the direct image of the vessels. That is called digital subtracted angiogram. So DSA. So this is a very useful technique for the AVM. So in AVM, what happens? This is the artery, this is the nidus, this is the draining vein. So this is called arteriovenous malformation. And you see with a digital subtraction angiogram, you can see there is a AVM here. And you can see there are three things are available, 2D, 3D, 4D DSA also. This is 2D, this is 3D, and this 4D, you can easily identify. If you ask your radiologist anything is there, take the advantage. This is the MR angio. You can see if the DSA is not available in your CT or something, you can take, this is the MR angio, you can find out the nidus here. This is the temporal AVM up here, and this is the, it is not visible on the proper image, but with angio you can differentiate. This is the left basal ganglia. You can see here left basal ganglia after treatment. This is the residue. This is the response here. So you can see here the AVM here, this is the hypointense, this is the slightly enhanced, this is the totally hypointense, this contrast slightly visible, but in MRI you can see the proper visible things here, and this is the T1 contrast. So this is the AVM in various MRI sequences. Then we have to plan for the vestibular schwannoma. You have to take the fiesta sequence, CISA sequence, cranial nerve and brainstem, T2 for the cochlea. And CT is very difficult to identify the lesion because it is the intracanalicular part, it is adjacent to the petrous bone. So intensities are mostly same. So you have to take an MR and contrast enhancement. You can find out the cystic components. As the tumor grows, you can find the cystic components and the CSF collections, that is CSF localization. So you have to find by T2, you can see peritumal arachnoid cysts. And if it is more high-grade tumor, more size tumor, you will see the heterogeneous enhancement. See, this is the intracanalicular part. You can visually here. If you take a CT, you cannot differentiate from the bone into intracanalicular part. So MR is needed. Like that, it is ice cream cone appearance here, slowly growing. But in a larger lesion, you can see here, this is the heterogeneous enhancement. Then planning MRI for the pituitary adenomas. You see the FETs are in the star sequence or CISA sequence for the cranial nerve and the brainstem. So imaging for the preferences for the pituitary adenoma, you can see here, you can ask for the T1 and contrast. For peaking material differentiation, you can ask for a FETs or star sequence. Optic chiasma identification, you can ask for the CISS or inversion recovery sequence. And cavernous sinus differentiation, T2 and FAIR sequence, this sequence is to be asked for. Let's see, explain. This is a pituitary tumor. I told T2, the vessels looks darker. Here tumor looks brighter and vessels look darker. So you can see the cavernous sinus in this area. You can differentiate here whether it is approaching or attaching to the cavernous sinus or not. So here we cannot differentiate. Here you can differentiate easily from the cavernous sinus. So it is needed, P2 sequence is needed to see the cavernous sinus involvement. the FEDSAT sequence where I told differentiating from the packing material, you have to ask for the FEDSAT sequence. Another sequence for the meningioma, you have to take delayed contrast, FEDSAT sequence. If there is a packing material like in the sphenoid meningiomas or supracellular meningiomas, and you ask for the DOTAS nuclear scan, DOTATOX scan. So if you see, this is a convexity meningioma here. It is brightly enhancing here. So there is a DOTATOX scan. What is strongly expressed, it is the meningioma expresses the somatostatin receptor subtype 2, improves the target volume definition, and in complex meningiomas like stall-based meningiomas, olfactory groove meningiomas, where you cannot differentiate from the bony lesion, bony structures, you ask for the DOTAS scan. So if you can see these lesions where the lesions are very same intensity with the bone, and this you can see the DOTAS scan, you can ask for. Another thing is re-irradiation. It is called a pseudoprogression, necrosis, recurrence. Any re-irradiation, if you are going ahead, PNR status. You know the understand the PNR status. You have to differentiate from the pseudoprogression, necrosis, and the recurrence. So what are the ammunitions we have? We have MRS, perfusion, PSMA scan. So any scan and ADC value, but that is a diffusion scan. So if it is a high blood flow, highly perfused, this is a glioma. Low blood flow, low perfused, this is a radiation changes. So this is the perfusion algorithm for the glioma versus metastasis for the necrosis. So when there is highly perfused, means high grade tumor, more new angiogenesis, you will get the glioma or metastasis. But if there is a low blood flow, low perfusion, you can go for the this one for the radiation necrosis. So progression, it is a new enhancing lesion, also necrosis also enhancing lesion. Increase choline peak, but in slight increase chronic peak. Decrease NNA level, normal NNA level. Increase perfusion, it increase lipid lactate. Decrease perfusion and low, here low ADC value, and it is a normal or high ADC value. So these are the differentiation between the progression and necrosis you can find out. Another thing is called, there is a various radionuclide scans are coming. If there is a, this is a normal PET. So high, there are lots of background optics, but if you take the PSMA scan, you can see the normal background, it is not visible. Only the tumor recurrence is the optic is there. So you have to ask for the PSMA scan if it is available in your city. Other rare tumors, this is a glossopharyngeal schwannoma, jugular schwannoma. This is the cavernomas, blood vessels, hypothalamic hamartomas. These are giving seizures. In these conditions, you can go for the various images as per the literature. So you can go for the, this is the sequences. As I told, normal anatomy, FSPGR, pituitary star, trigeminal fiesta, cranial nerve CISS, CP angle GRE, glioma, diffusion, perfusion, ABM, angio, grading, MRS, metastasis, double, triple, delayed, diffusion, perfusion. You can ask, you can follow this. Right. So MRI spine and sequence. This is what I am told about this brain. Now let's come to the MRI spine and sequence. So why MRI is needed? To have proper delineation of GTV, CTV, PTV, and extent of the tumor, marrow, and soft tissue involvement. MRI has the highest consistency in controlling the GTV of metastasis. T2, TIR are commonly used. You can ask for the diffusion weighted image. Post contrast can be used to improve the specificity. So if you see, this is the normal anatomy of the spine. This is the vertebral body. This is the pedicle. This is the transverse process. This is the superior articular facet. This is the lamina. This is the spinous process. This is the spinal canal. You can see this is the normal anatomy of the vertebral body. Here, according to the ISRSC guideline, International Spino Radiosurgery Consortium, you can see the vertebral bodies, they're divided into six parts. If you see, go for the clockwise direction, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So if you see, this is the body is the first part, pedicle is 2, the lamina is 3, spinous process is 4, right side lamina is 5, and life set particularly 6. So these are the various 6 parts. When you are asking for the, when are asking for a MR spine, you just ask these sectors in, define the sectors by radiologist. this is the you can have more anatomy if you go. This is the vertebral body, this is the disc, and this is the articular facet, transverse process, lamina. You can see here that this is a T2 weighted image. You can see the thecal sac and the spinal canal, and this is the disc. You can go ahead with anatomy as per like. So if you see the axial image, this is the spinal cord, this is the dorsal root, this is the cerebrospinal fluid, which looks brighter, that is T2, and various vertebral bodies, vertebral artery canal, that is a cervical vertebra, and this is the spinal cord, and this is the ligamentum flavum, which is attached to the spinous process. If you go to the sacral, this is the spinal canal, where you can see the CSV, which looks bright. This is the ala, this is the ileocecal junction, this is the right, this is the left, this is the front, and this is the sacral base, and this is the sacral front. So if you see the some sagittal image, you see the vertebral body, you can see the disc spaces here. This is the conus medullaris, this is the where spinal cord ends, this is the conus medullaris, this is conus medullaris, this is the CSF, this is CSF, and this is the cauda equina, the nerve fibers. So what are the spine sequences are available? T1, T2, star, T1 contrast, Dixon, diffusion awaited, and susceptible to weighted illness. So what are the MRI sequences? Basic sequences is the T1, T2, inversion recovery, and post contrast. If you are thinking more, you can ask for the advanced sequence called DWI, like the functional sequence, SWI, that is susceptible to weighted image, and multi-point Dixon sequence, and dynamic post contrast T1. Let's discuss one by one. One thing I want to tell you, how to identify T1 sequence, T2 sequence, star sequence. How to identify? Let's see. T1 sequence. This is a CSF is black. This is a T1 sequence. CSF is a black. T1 sequence. CSF is bright. This is T2 sequence. Here, star sequence is the suppression of the PET. So how will you differentiate here? You see the backside PET. This is brighter in T1 and T2, but suppressed in the star sequence. So if the CSF is white, CSF is dark, T1, CSF white, T2, abdominal, CSF is white, but the abdominal fat or back fat is darker, then it is a star sequence. Let's see, in T1 sequences, most of the lesions look hypointense. T1 sequence, most of the lesions look hypointense. In T2 sequence, it looks hyperintense. Sorry, this is T1 contrast. This is a dynamic post contrast assess. If you see the EGFR status of patient, bone metastasis, there will be high uptake around this tumor. This is T2 sequence. You can see here, this is a hyperintense. You can see the tumor here, it is a hyperintense. This is a hyperintense. You can see here. But if you suppress the vertebral bone marrow fats, you suppress it, this is a T2 sequence. You can see the tumor looks hyperintense, other vertebrals also looks hyperintense. But if you ask for the IR sequence, you can see the vertebral body here. These are the marrows. If you suppress, and tumor looks more brighter. So if you see that here, the tumor, the volume of tumor you can see here, volume of tumor you can see in the IR sequence. This is the inversion equation. How to identify? See the back fat. Back fat is whiter, T2, CSF white, T2, CSF white, T, but back fat is black with IR sequence. Another sequence called diffusion weighted sequence, where you like that brain, you can see the restricted diffusion, you can looks brighter here. Another sequence is called susceptibility weighted MRI, where either is an osteoblastic lesion or osteolytic lesion. If you want to differentiate, take the susceptibility weighted MRI spine. So if you see the, if you do the delineation CT here, T2 here, so see the volume in the changes. IR sequence, it is more here. T1 contrast slightly here. And if you configure the diffusion weighted image, volume definitely changes. So always ask for these five sequences so that you can delineate the properly about the spine metastasis. So summary, PTMR should be in same slice thickness. We should be in the cartouche. Discuss with radiologist before sending to the radiologist. fused properly, delineate with radiologist, get the result. Thank you very much. Hope you understand. You have some questions, you can ask me.
So very nice presentation, Dr. Kanu, really very nice and very impressive, and very nicely you have enumerated the very difficult thing in very nice manner. So I have a question. So how much contrast you used to prefer, double contrast, double dose or triple dose?
Usually I ask for the double dose. I have never asked for the triple dose.
Yeah, normally we are also here, we are using 10 ml contrast normally, but now for brain mets we are asking for 20 ml contrast. And okay, at which time you are taking a delayed imaging?
Delayed imaging also I have not asked, now I am going to ask after studying this.
Yeah, so some literature says 5 minutes, some says 15 minutes, so we have taken on the middle of that, let us 10 minutes.
Anybody, any questions, they can ask. You can unmute everybody.
So I am unmuting everyone. So it's not working.
Okay.
Just okay. I am trying it. It's I am clicking the unmute section, but it is not unmuting. So any question in the meanwhile, you just write down. I am just trying to unmute all.
Hello. Kanu, can you hear me?
Yeah, Dr. Sanjukta, you are audible. You can ask question.
Then everybody is unmuted. Students, you can ask questions to Kanu. Aditya? I think they have to unmute their own microphone.
Yes.
Rasmi, you tell them.
Yeah, so you can all unmute your yourself. Dr. Aditya, are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so you unmute yourself and any question you can ask.
Sir, can you please explain the 3D FSPGR sequence again?
3D FSPGR sequence. It is just a sequence. If you see, in 3D FSPGR sequence, this is a normal anatomy sequence. You can see the properly, So 3D FSPGR sequence, it is FSPGR sequence, that is first spoil gradient echo. It is a 3D, you ask for the 3D, you should not ask for the simple. So they will give axial, as well as the sagittal coronal they will give. Apart from that, you can see very differentiate. You cannot differentiate any, you cannot differentiate cranial nodes and optic chiasma in the T1, T2 sequence. You can find, you see this optic chiasma, how it is visible clearly 3D FSPGR sequence. But remember one thing, the name difference different from different component. D is FSPGR, Philips is FFG, Siemens is the empirical sequence. So when you were discussing radiologist, ask which company we have. So accordingly, you ask.
Thank you, sir.
Any more questions?
So it is presumed that everybody understood.
Then Dr. Kanu will ask the question to the students. So how much do they understood? Dr. Kanu, I want to just, in the initial slides, you have just explained the different, this is also very important what we are seeing in the front. So in the initial sequences, you have just, that field of view, I have missed it. So can you explain it again, field of view?
Field of view, So there are two things to understand field of view. It is called a CT or MRI board. That is 85 centimeter, 70 centimeter, mostly radiation department, 85 centimeter board. But the field of view, to see more resolution, they will take small image, big small area, big image. This is the field of view, small FOV. This is the full FOV. In small FOV, if you see, you can see the good resolution, but you cannot fuse properly. CT, it is a full body contour. Here, no body contour will be there. Only that area will be there. So when you are asking, always ask for the full FOV, not small FOV.
Okay. And for trigemin, yes, ma'am. Yes, you go ahead.
Kanu?
Yes, ma'am.
You have to ask full FOV.
You have to ask for full FOV so that fuse will be okay. Otherwise, fusion will be very difficult.
Okay.
And for trigeminal neuralgia, which sequence you have told?
FS-PGR sequence.
FS-PGR sequence. Okay.
Sorry. Fiesta sequence.
Fiesta sequence. Okay.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Any questions, you can drop at me and your email or can call me. I can ask. You can ask and I will not ask. Thank you.
Everybody are having your WhatsApp number, so they will WhatsApp you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Rasmi.
Thanks for the time.
Dr. Kanu, can I stop the recording now?
Stop the recording and it will be saved in your desktop or some laptop. So just forward the things to me.
Okay, so after saving it, it will be saved in my desktop or I have to just make it to save in desktop?
Save in desktop.
Option I have to put the.
So stop recording will be rahega.
Okay.
Then she has to mail it to you.
Yes, she has to mail
it. So that Tanu can share it.
Okay, I will do that.